This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, today is going to be an unusual Dreamland because it's just me. I'm going to be talking about Lou Elizondo's new book, Imminent, and going into it in some detail. We're going to be a little different from the reviews you'll be hearing. Rich Dolan on his podcast did a wonderful, very skilled professional review, as is normal with Rich. He's a top guy. But it's quite different from a review by an experiencer. First of all, I review this book as the second in a series. The first in that series is the Jim Lakotsky, Colm Kelleher, George Knapp book, Hunt for the Skinwalker. I interviewed, George and Colm on Dreamland in 2021, but of course you can watch that and listen to that if you're a subscriber, in detail about that book. I want to do this more from the perspective of an experiencer. What does this mean to an experiencer, to us experiencers, that this is happening? And how does what Lou have to say relate to the experience? Well, I think it relates in a lot of ways. First, he is an experiencer himself. He just doesn't think of himself as that. But anyone who is seeing orbs in their home is an experiencer. And that is part of what's happening with him. Now, I want you to think back. Many of you have seen orbs. When I am here in this apartment and do especially my late night meditation around 3 a.m., they're often here. They're welcome here. They don't feel like something bad at all. Now, why is that? And why is it so different from what Lou reports, which is a very negative sense of that presence? Is there something wrong with Lou's approach or mine? Is Lou a soldier and they're reacting to him as if he is a member of a hostile military force? Or do I have Stockholm syndrome? That's a question that's not answerable just yet, but it's very important for the Lou Elizondos and the Whitley Striebers of the world to both accept the idea that the question is not answered. The United States Air Force does not accept that idea. And this is referred to at times in the book. The Air Force, many of the Air Force personnel and personnel higher up in the defense establishment believe that these are demons, that we're dealing with demons, which is one of the reasons there's so little disclosure. Demons are supposed to be ignored. Noticing them gives them power, traditionally. But wait a minute. Should we really be referring to medieval and earlier conceptions of non-human intelligences now and acting on those and making policy based on those, which is what we are doing? It becomes very clear in this book that that's a big part of it. I don't think so. I'm quite concerned about it, in fact, very concerned. I would like to talk about orbs in the context of what Lou Elizondo says about Brazil and the Brazilian experience. There is a general he talks about, General Uchoa, who launched Brazil's UAP studies program back in the 1970s. And Lou talked to his son, also a general, named Paul Roberto Yog de Miranda Uchoa. And here's the interesting thing. they mention, and this is mentioned in Robert Pratt's book also, that orbs often hurt people in Brazil. And in fact, if you compare, as I do in my new book, The Fourth Mind, the Brazilian experience as a whole with the U.S. experience, is two very, very different approaches taking place. In Brazil, people tended to be chased down and injured in various ways. There's not too many stories of abduction. In the United States, they were carefully taken, abducted, and generally brought back, almost always brought back, pretty much intact, and a lot of times without knowing that anything happened. I remember after my abduction, I thought I'd encountered an owl in the house. In other words, there was a screen memory that had been placed there. It didn't last long. The screen memory fell apart. No one in the Brazilians didn't have that experience. They ended up running down past through the woods trying to get away from these things, being shot with blasts of light and all sorts of things. People were injured, a lot of people. Why was it different? What was the difference? This gets me to a possibility that Lou doesn't discuss directly, but sort of, at one point, sort of circles around. And that is the possibility that there has been a negotiation with these people, and that what is happening in the United States is a result of that negotiation. Could that be the case? And there was no such negotiation in Brazil? And would our abduction experience be the same as Brazil's if that hadn't happened? I can't answer the question, but I do think the question should be there. I'm not saying this. I'm not making a statement about it. But I am saying that Imminent brings up this and quite a few other questions. I would like now to move on down the road to a few other things. He speaks about Hal Puthoff extensively, and Hal, of course, has played an enormous role in all of this. Hal and I have been friends, and I would say good friends, since 1988, since Communion came out, or probably maybe the year before, I don't recall. But we have spent many, many hours together talking about this stuff and speculating about it. Hal has listened to my stories. And here's where I think Hal comes from. Hal is a Catholic, and Hal has seen a lot of dark stuff. Dark stuff. And I think he thinks this is quite dangerous. And I personally am not sure. It's no longer dangerous to me, at least not at the moment. It was very, very trying at first. Extremely difficult. Soul-shattering. It was a real initiation. Jeff Kripal will tell you that an initiation means a turning over of the life. And that's what happened to me on December the 26th, 1985. I went to bed that night living one life and came staggering out the next morning living another life. Interestingly enough, I think that the abductions or the attempt on the visitor's part to contact me started the previous summer. I haven't written about that yet, but I will touch on it in my new book, The Fourth Mind. I think they basically ran out of patience and sort of shook me awake in December. But let's get back to this question of Hal and Eric Davis and Jim Lakotsky. It's sad to see what happens to Jim Lakotsky in the story, and for that matter, by extension, to Hal and to Eric Davis. They are slowly circled by negative influences within the bureaucracy, and it's like a wound being surrounded by scar tissue, and they're eventually expelled into the atmosphere. And it's always, it seems to me, for the same reason. Somebody thinks that we should not deal with this. Could it be the Collins elite, the very right-wing Christian organization in the Pentagon? If so, then why is it that the Pentagon, that the right wing embraces this and will, like, where does, you see Lou Elizondo, you see him on Joe Rogan. You saw him on CBS this morning too, but you see him on Joe Rogan. You see him, you're going to see him in other places like that. And you have to ask yourself the question, where's the left? Well, and he mentions that Daniel Inouye, the former senator from Hawaii, who was a Democrat and pretty much of a lefty, was interested in this. And of course, Harry Reid was a Democrat, more moderate, and very, very interested in this. When I was briefly contacted by the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence in the mid-90s, they were basically all Democrats. It was the Democrats were in power in the Senate at the time. But if you look at the left in the media in this country, you're not going to find Lou Elizondo on very many left-leaning podcasts. There's something going on there in the heads of people that has to change. Both sides and everyone in the middle, we have to unite on this in the same way that the congressional committee that opened the floor to David Grush, David Fravor, and the others did. It was, you had people from the far left and the far right and every shading in between on that committee, symbolizing the fact that Congress is willing to do this as a Congress, not factionally. We got to keep going down that road. Now, I'd also like to talk about a gentleman in the book named Will Livingston. I know who Will is. It's a pseudonym in the book. And if you knew Will, you would understand when Lou mentions that he can be a little testy, exactly why that is. He is an MD. He has studied this noggin, and he studied the brains of many, many people who are unusual and have unusual lives. And he's primarily a neurologist. And he is more of a scientist, I think. I don't think that I would get an opinion from him as to what these creatures are. But I think I would get an opinion from him that they can be very violently aggressive. In my book, Them, I make reference to a, and this is not mentioned in Lou's book, as far as I have read, and I've read the whole book, obviously, I wouldn't be talking to you, that there was briefly on the internet, and I found a copy of it, fortunately, the MRI scan of a pilot who had been hit by a weapon that had damaged his brain. This weapon demyelinized parts of his brain to the extent that he died. Now, when you say demyelinized, what you mean is the myelin sheath around the nerves was destroyed. That kills the nerve. Where do you see that? Where else do you see that? The answer is, you see it in the Havana syndrome. And now we assume that the Havana syndrome, and there was a brilliant piece on 60 Minutes suggesting that there was a Russian involved in Havana syndrome. That would mean to me that they have back engineered that weapon. I've said this to everyone I know in this field on the inside, and it's a lot of people. And nobody seems to have responded to me. But then again, I don't have a security clearance. I don't want one. I've never signed a non-disclosure agreement. I never will. So they may simply not be able to tell me what they're doing. But I do think there's a connection. And I think that one of the things that's going to happen over the next few years is we are going to see more and more of this kind of thing happening, back engineering of materials and processes and technology. And I think some of the technology that the visitors have is spectacularly toxic, even more toxic than that type of weapon, which gets me to two areas, and I'm going to go a little bit around about here, that Hal talks about one extensively and about the other not at all. And I think the second one is more important than the first. The first one, of course, is remote viewing. Hal talks extensively about the remote viewing program and about its sad demise. Basically, it was killed by religious fundamentalists who felt it was demonic in nature. And okay, I mean, that's their privilege. But at the same time, they killed a useful program. Or did they really kill it? And did it just go deeper into the government? That we can't know on the outside. But I will say this. The U.S. government is a great big maze, and there's plenty of hidey holes in it. So that program may still exist somewhere under another name and being funded goodness only knows how. So that's one thing. The next thing I want to talk about in regard to this is telepathy. Remote viewing, yes, it works. Hopefully it's still there somewhere. There are lots of ways of learning remote viewing, and you can probably learn it yourself. And you'll find if you do, and you do remote viewing, and you are effective at it, and it's very important to understand, you're not going to be remote viewing your wife to see if she has a lover and succeeding. It will not work. Absolutely not. Because your emotions are engaged, and as soon as that happens, forget it. It's over. You're not remote viewing anymore, and you never will be in that subject matter. You have to come to it with a very objective vision of what you're trying to do. You may have a specific goal. That you practice remote viewing by being basically given things to remote view that are sealed up in envelopes that you haven't seen before and so forth. And there are lots of remote viewing programs out there that you can take. You just have to go on the internet. I'm not going to recommend one or the other because I'm sure a lot of them work. And you can learn to remote view, and it can empower you in very extraordinary ways because you can sometimes succeed in remote viewing things in the future. And that can be quite useful, believe me. I know that a group of remote viewers tried to remote view future commodities prices or stock prices or something and had some success. But it was limited success. I would definitely not put all my eggs in that basket at all. In any case, there's something that he brushes past that I think is more important than remote viewing. This is telepathy. Now, we hardly ever talk about telepathy. And is it because of the fact that it is such an important secret? Because many of you close encounter witnesses will have had telepathic moments. I know I certainly have. It's real. The visitors can use it fluently. In fact, some of them, I don't think they can even talk. They don't have the vocal cords for that. They can make sounds, but they can't articulate words. And that's because they have evolved telepathy so completely that any ability to create speech is simply atrophied. They can make sounds. I mean, I've heard them make sounds that are incredibly emotionally powerful, but they speak in the head only. So that's real. That's there. And my question is this. Let me back up a bit. I have been in places in the past year or so where human telepaths have been present. I haven't known, frankly, whether they were hybrids or not. I am sensitive enough to this to pick it up when it's directed at me, and it was directed at me in a few cases. I believe that we may have a telepathy program. I hope we do. Because another interesting thing about this is that we think always, well, the Russians or the Chinese might do it. Not necessarily. And the reason is that it's very hard to do these things, things like remote viewing and telepathy, unless you're really truly free inside. It takes a kind of inner freedom to do this, where you don't feel hemmed in by the culture. And in dictatorships, you're always hemmed in one way or another. Like, I cannot imagine a remote viewer or telepath succeeding very well in North Korea. It's impossible, because here's your remote viewer, and it's the death penalty. If you fail, you'll fail. You might as well kiss yourself goodbye. But in the West, remote viewing is used. I think it's even used corporately now fairly frequently. And telepathy is used. In fact, regarding remote viewing, there's a wonderful show about remote viewing Whitley Strieber on the Dreamland archive somewhere. It was done fairly recently. It was a lot of fun. And they were fairly accurate. I wouldn't say they were completely accurate, but they were certainly accurate enough to where it was far beyond chance. Telepathy could be an enormously powerful tool and weapon. I've experienced enough telepathy to know that it can be whispered into your mind in such a way that it feels like your own thoughts. You have to have had a significant amount of experience with it before you can tell this is happening to you. And a good telepath can ease their thoughts into your thoughts in such a way that you can't tell. I know of a situation where a man was with one of these insiders walking past a certain building on an airbase, and the insider said, as they walked past the building, "Sing yourself a song, because there are people in the building who can hear your thoughts." Well, I have other methods, and don't forget this. Singing a song is all well and good, but there are other methods, such as saying repetitive prayer, that is good on a whole lot of different levels. The Jesus prayer is one that's very good. A lot of the old Hindu mantras and Buddhist mantras are very good. Even just a snatch of song that's a silly doggerel or something, repeating that again and again can help. But the problem is, you have to learn to think behind this. And this is a technique like riding a bicycle. And nobody ever talks about this, so I'm talking about it now. You can learn to project the repetitive voice in the front of your mind while using the back of your mind to speak. So you can think and wall yourself off at the same time. The critical thing is, though, a really good telepath is going to get into you before you know they're there. And once they're into you, forget it. You're not going to get away. You have been pawned, as they say. You've been got. And so the fact that this man was told to be careful walking past that building tells me that we do have telepaths operating in this country. Whether they're human, alien, or hybrid, I don't know. But I'm sure we do have them. And I think it's great. I think it's a tremendously powerful tool. If it's used wisely, it's going to help our country and ultimately mankind. But how much can it help us as long as it remains secret? And that goes to all of this. It's why Colm Kelleher, George Knapp and Jim Lukacsky wrote their book. It's why David Grush went out there in front of the country and the Congress and said what he said. It's why Lou Elizondo put himself on the line and got this book out after starting talking. It's why these people did this. They did it for you and me. And my hat is really off to them for that. It took courage. Both David Grush and Lou had to resort to the Whistleblower Act, which is a kiss of death in the intelligence community. When you go that route, you're finished. Your career is over. And they had to endure the grotesque tarnishing of their reputations, dragging up of things about them and their past to try to make them look bad. Hell, compared to what happened to David Grush, I got off easy by having my rape turned into a joke. So these guys have struggled and suffered for this out of love of country, love of you, and love of mankind. And that has to be profoundly respected. Someone's going to ask the question, are you ever going to interview Lou Elizondo? Well, the answer is I don't know. So far, he hasn't been willing to interview with me. But we know each other. We're not. I wouldn't say we're close friends by any means. Not like with Hal, who I'm very friendly with. But and Hal will not interview with me. Forget it. I've been asking him about that for 10 years or more. And anyway, maybe Lou will. I don't know. I would like that because it will be the only view. It will be the only interview where I hope intellectually competent and committed experiencer interviews a man like him. And I'm certainly not going to interview him about the experience, but I would like to interview him about what is in the book from the perspective of an experiencer, which is what I'm trying to do right now, in fact. And as before we go on, I would like to ask all of you subscribers to tell your friends about Unknown Country and Dreamland, and try to get them to get engaged and maybe even subscribe. And all of you non-subscribers, please do it. Go to the site, go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe. You will not hear this from anyone else. And I have to tell you, I'm on a mission and I depend on you. I have to keep on this mission at all costs. It's a very important mission, I feel. It's going to take you cracking your pocketbook to help me keep going. You don't have to crack it wide. It's $5 a month at the minimum, $40, $39.50 a year. That is not exactly a lot for what you get here. So please do it. Okay, let's move on now. I want to talk about the crash victims and the autopsies. Now, David Grush, now Lou Elizondo, have both alluded to what I found out years ago from General Exon, indirectly from General Exon. I have to say he never spoke directly to me about this, that there were bodies, and presumably the bodies were autopsied. Now, what does that mean in terms of this whole process? And it's a bigger question than it seems. Because remember, a little while ago, we were talking about orbs. Now we're talking about bodies. So where are these people? What are they? I'm going to discuss this extensively in The Fourth Mind in my new book. I believe that these people are, that they can enter and leave their bodies at will, or perhaps under a certain rule. I don't know. I don't know how the details of it work, because they can leave the body. We can leave our bodies, but it ain't easy. I think that this world is our primary world. That's why we're basically locked in here. I think their primary reality is a level of consciousness that is non-physical, and that they enter the world of the body only when they need to. This is a huge difference between us. And it would also explain why it could be that the Roswell craft was a donation, along with the bodies, a donation. Because they wouldn't think of death the same way we do. For us, death of the body is death of the person. I don't think it's the same for them. I think that the person lives on no matter what happens to the body in their world. And I think that we need to understand this. I think it's very important that we understand what this means. Because one of the things it certainly means is that they are very, very different from us. I think that their bodies are probably very much integral to the machines. And the reason that we didn't see any propulsion devices is that the propulsion devices were in the morgue, basically. And it was through mind, the mind connection to the ship, that it made it fly. That it was the mind connection with the ship that made it fly. Something like that. Something so far from where we are, we can't even imagine it. But don't be so sure. In 1850, nobody knew that radio existed. In the 1860s, it was theorized that it might exist. In the 1880s, it was discovered it did exist. In the 1890s, we began to make tools, radio-based tools. We could talk to each other over long distances invisibly. We could talk to each other over long distances invisibly. A remarkable discovery. So let's not be certain that these people are very far ahead of us, that they are so far in advance of us intellectually, in terms of knowledge, in terms of the ability to fabricate devices, technology, and so forth. They must also be so far ahead of us morally that you can't believe it. I don't think so. I think that the jump from where we are now to where we're going to be in a few years is going to be extraordinary. And that we will be very much like them in just a few years, not looking like them, but having the same level of knowledge they do and a similar ability to apply that knowledge. I think that's where we're going. And I think Lou does too. And I think that this book is about that. That is the central theme. That's why it's called Imminent. And he might know something that we don't know. He might know that the visitors are showing up. I got the impression from them, and I don't want to say they told me because that's not the case. I really don't know how I come by some of this information, but some of it turns out to be pretty good. I got the impression from them that they would not show up until every single one of us knew the planet could not survive. I want to read a section of the book now, just a brief passage that's very, very important, the importance of which is not going to be noticed by many people. But you'll find I'm right. This is in regard to the shutting down of the remote viewing program. Some say the budget was the issue, but most knew the truth. They killed the program because it was too effective. Too effective. That said, I wouldn't assume that means elements of the government have not continued using remote viewing as a tool. I alluded to this earlier, and of course they have, and they do. In fact, I don't want to speak out of turn here, but drug enforcement and human trafficking, all of those areas use remote viewing. And other areas do too. It's possible to remote view the visitors, and are they ever aware of that if you do it? Don't play with that particular fire. Believe me, that can become a very serious game. All right. Anyway, religious fundamentalists within the chain of command at Capitol Hill began asking pointed questions about the program and its efficacy. Specifically, are these unusual methods paranormal or demonic? I remember very well in the late 90s when this was going down, and these methods, this was the fact that it was accurate was the reason that they wanted to kill it, because they thought that these people, General Stubblebine and Hal and people like that, were drawing the United States into an alliance of demons. And yet, you know, there's so much I want to say here. And I'm not going to say. Not yet. Yeah. Suffice to say, that's not exactly what was happening. But what was happening and does happen with things like remote viewing is that we get to a level of experience and relationship that is very different from what you and I know in our daily lives. There is a level of commitment to good and evil that's different from the way we are. We do good things, we do evil things all the time. You can get into a situation where you can't do anything good. You can get into a situation where you can't do anything evil. You can get into these situations. And yeah, that's the definition of angels and demons. But nevertheless, those of us who are free, and we are free, we have free will here, we can still work with both sides. But be careful. Be very, very careful. Anne left an invocation that is terribly important to understanding what I'm going to be talking about next from Imminent, and also where we need to go with this. Because we've got the dark and the light here, and we have to learn to live with both. Anne knew how to do this. Now, let's step back from good and evil to dark and light alone. This is an invocation that I say every single day of my life that was written by my wife, given to me. We ask the light to open the doors of our hearts and the dark to open the doors of our minds, that we may receive the richness of being from the light and the richness of knowledge from the dark. We ask those wiser than us to protect us and help us to see, balance, and use what is given to us. It's not going to work if you push the demons aside and only go for the angels. You have to give each side its due. And your knowledge of yourself comes to you out of your own darkness. It's looking into that dark, like the hermit card in the tarot with his lantern held high. He's looking into his own dark. Now let's go on with the book. You know, this is not like the reviews you're going to be hearing here and there at all. It's a very different kind of review. All right. Theoretically, Jim Lakatsky and his team ran the U.S.'s official program on the UAP, but at the same time, the legacy program was working at cross purposes to ours. Now, why he calls it the legacy program, I'm not absolutely clear. Let me go on. In the parlance of the Pentagon, some deeply hidden black programs were so black. Well, they weren't even black. They were ultra black. We spoke of purple novas, projects and programs so secret that not even the Secretary of Defense or the President would ever know of them unless they stumbled upon them by accident, which, by the way, would never happen. Remembering what Hal told me earlier, why brief somebody who was only in office for a short period of time? Why jeopardize security? That was the mindset of those in the legacy program. Nothing is more black than the legacy program. Let's talk a little bit about what's in the legacy program and what is so black. And then I'm going to call a halt to this. I've already had to stop and go into a deep trance at one point during the course of this struggle to get this out. And it is a struggle, believe me. Okay. There are programs that these guys don't know anything about. And I only know them because they've touched my life in different ways. One of the ways they've touched my life is this implant in my ear. This came from one of those ultra-black programs. You will not find anything anywhere about that program. And the reason is the program's management is right on the edge of what we think of as the visitors and us, the living and the dead. Remember I said earlier that some of the visitors, or maybe all of the visitors, can enter and leave their bodies at will. Our dead are heavily involved in this, technologically even. And these deep black programs are where that interface exists. Nobody has ever spoken of this before. But it's the truth. It's the truth. A man I respected deeply died a few years ago. He was profoundly important on this interface. He has a wonderful, spectacularly successful public career in space sciences, but also a deeper career, which was very, very important to me. He introduced me to some tall whites, some Nordics, and he was a soldier in a desperately dangerous war, tripping along the top of the fence or the high wire, and at one point he slipped off and there was a significant problem. He lost a lot in his home. He had a beautiful home. He lost that home and to a fire as a result of this, and moved from where he was in the central United States to a safe zone, which is where I lived in, near my cabin, or around that area, and where it's a kind of neutral zone. And he was there for many years and then moved back to his beloved home before he died. Now, what was he doing? He worked on an interface between the physicals and the non-physicals. This is a coherent world, this non-physical world. It is not a bunch of airy-fairy nonsense about ghosts and whatnot. It's real. It is not a single conscious entity kind of floating out there. It is very, very complex, but woven together much more profoundly than this world is woven together. We're really isolated in these bodies, and we're supposed to be. There's nothing wrong with this. this is how we're supposed to be. How we're supposed to be. They're not supposed to be this way. They are living in this ever increasingly complex weave. The implant links me to that weave. And that's where my books come from. It's where the next book, The Fourth Mind, is coming from. It's where Them came from. It's where A New World came from. It's where Afterlife Revolution came from. Living on this interface is what I do. This is my life. I'm not a member of any black programs, by the way. I don't go to any secret meetings or anything like that. I said before, and I'll say it again, I am absolutely not connected in any way officially to anything. And I cannot be, because I couldn't function the way I do if I was. Anyway, these legacy programs they're really calling the shots, I think. Still, probably. I think that the visitors, as I've touched on in my earlier books, in both The New World and in Them, and I will touch on it more in A Fourth Mind, they do not want us in this level to become too knowledgeable too fast. Because if we become too knowledgeable too fast, it's going to be like we'll be burned out. We won't be able to use what we know, and we won't make it. And we have to make it. We have to make it. The planet Earth is rarer than you can imagine. It is not one of trillions of planets in a universe teeming with intelligent life at all. That any level of consciousness in the physical can reach the level of complexity that we are at is absolutely vanishingly rare. There's loads of living planets, but not many of these. Not many of these. What we do, our bodies capture experience novelly. In other words, every second is new to you and me. It's always all new. When you're at the other level where those legacy programs live, nothing is new like that. You are outside of the stream of time manipulating it. This is what the implant does. It takes me to the edge of the stream of time, and I can learn a great deal at that edge and communicate it. That's what I do. That's my job. So, okay. Anyway, it's an absolutely wonderful book, and I think that he touches on things like the journey of Enoch and the Bible, and he really goes closer and closer to where we need to be as a country, as a government, as a species, as people, in order to really move ahead. We all need to learn to live on this edge as best we can. Right on the edge between the realities, this is where growth occurs, and this is where we, the human species, belong. And in this wonderful, extraordinary book, Luis Elizondo has touched that nerve and touched it with a gentle, gentle touch that can only bring benefits to us all.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.